Right, good evening everyone. Very excited to be with you. For those who don't know, my name is Ryan. I'm an intern here at the church. I actually started a message with a similar phrase. Interns tend to make silly mistakes. I made a silly mistake yesterday and got sunburned really badly. The wrath of the sun was not very kind, and so my legs look like red Viennas. I'm in a bit of discomfort, so just give me grace for that if I look like I'm waddling around. But I am very excited to be preaching the last installment, the last installment of our Was Is Always series. And we've been going for, about 10 weeks now, I think, through attributes of God. Things about God, truths about God that tell us who He is and give us fuel to worship Him. And that's been the real heart of the series, not just to look at who God is, but why that matters in terms of worship. That it would inspire us and encourage us to engage in worship, appropriate worship, that as we see how great He is, we would worship Him. And so we did it in three seasons. And so this is going to be sort of like those, I just want to do a bit of a last time on episode, whatever. And we're just going to look back. I just want to give you a quick run through of what we've looked at, because we've looked at so many things and they're all really great. And I want us to just catch up to where we are. And so we started in season one looking at the essence of God, and we looked at He was spirit, but He was also personal. And so He was unlike us in that He was completely spirit. He doesn't actually have hands or eyes. Those are just pictures that we use to understand how He acts. But He's also personal. We looked at that He is everywhere and eternal, and that blew our minds a bit. And we looked at how He was all-knowing and all-powerful. Enter season two, and we looked at some of the moral attributes of God, that He is unchanging and true, trustworthy, that He is happy, blessed God, and a good God, and that He is love. And season three, our last season, started off by looking at the holiness of God. And Joe really unpacked that. And that's really crucial for the next two, because Joe showed us that God is set apart from all that would be outside of Himself. He is uniquely perfect and uniquely pure. And so He is set apart from all sin and all evil. And that means that He responds to these things that are outside of Himself in different ways. And Brad looked at it very deeply last week. We looked at the wrath of God, or the wrath of God. And we looked at how He responds that way towards sin, because He is perfectly just, and it is the righteous response to that which offends Him. And tonight I get to close with what is probably the best one, and that is God's grace. Tonight we're looking at God's grace, which is God's goodness to an undeserving people. See, mercy, we sometimes understand, is God not giving us what we deserve. We deserve punishment, and so He doesn't give it to us. That is merciful. Grace is going over and above that to give us what we don't deserve. It is God's goodness towards an undeserving people. That is His grace, and that's what we're looking at tonight. And it is, actually, His most praiseworthy attribute. It is the thing about Himself that He wants us to be most excited about. The thing about Himself that He wants us to worship most fervently, because He's actually set up everything so that all of the universe would applaud His grace. The angels look at His grace towards us in Jesus, and they are dumbfounded. They don't understand it. See, God's glory is about Him being honored, and His grace is the peak of His glory. God's grace is the apex of His glory. He has set everything up, including the gospel and our salvation, so that His glory would be praised. It is His grace that He has chosen to be the most praiseworthy and amazing attribute of His whole person. And we've looked at so many great things over the last few weeks, but it is His grace that is meant to be praised when all is said and done. See, God's glory is about Him receiving honor, and His grace is what He will be most honored for in all eternity. We read in Ephesians 1, it says, "In love He predestined us for adoption to Himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of His will." This is the purpose of His will, to the praise of His glorious grace. See, the whole of the gospel, the whole of your salvation, your entire walk with God is meant to reflect back to God glory and honor and praise. But in particular, God, You are gracious. Yes, You are loving, and I praise You for that. But the most amazing thing about God is that we undeservedly get His goodness and presence in our lives. And so His grace is meant to be magnified Thomas Brooks was a Puritan, and he said something I thought was so profound. He said, grace and glory differ very little. The one is the seed, the other is the flower. Grace is glory militant, and glory is grace triumphant. See, grace is God's glory stepping into your life to save you. It's His glory, His honor, His person active in your life. And God's glory is when His grace comes to a conclusion and is triumphant. That at the end, you will be with Him for all eternity because His grace has seen you through. But I really want to focus on that picture of using the seed and the flower. Because whenever God sowed seeds of grace, it's always for the purpose of His glory. Every time He sows a seed of grace in your life, whether it is the big seed of your salvation, receiving Christ and being saved from your sin, or whether it's just little seeds of grace in your life, of His goodness, whenever God sows a seed of grace in your life, it is for His glory and His fame and His renown. And those seeds are meant to blossom into praise and worship His name. God's grace is glorious. It is His glorious grace. And the angels and all of creation marvel at it. They marvel at it. It is His perfect wisdom, His perfect justice, and His perfect love rolled up into one act and particularly manifested in what we call the gospel, the good news. And that's where I want to spend a lot of time this evening, unpacking the gospel of the grace of God, as Paul calls it in Acts 20. Paul says he gives his entire life, and his life would be meaningless unless he devotes it to preaching the gospel of the grace of God, the good news of God's goodness to undeserving people. So we're going to unpack that. But there's one thing we need to really understand. You see, the gospel, the good news, is ultimately a story. I want to do a bit of an illustration and hope it works. Who knows Lord of the Rings? Maybe just stick your hand up quickly. Okay, good. We've got a good... Okay, stick your hands down. If you don't know Lord of the Rings, you don't have to be embarrassed, although I am judging you a little bit. Won't you please stick your hand up quite high? I'm not making fun of you. I just want you to put your hand up. I just want to prove a point. Okay. Bring your hand down when I say... No. Keep your hand up now. When I say something that you don't understand, I want you to bring your hand down. Okay, we're going to start simple. Okay, elves, dwarves, orcs. Okay, there's some hands going down already. Mordor, Sauron, Saruman. Okay, people who know, you're like, how do you not know what that is? That's because you've watched Lord of the Rings. Okay, if you haven't watched Lord of the Rings, those words mean nothing to you. In fact, they're quite gibberish. And sometimes what happens is our familiarity with things about the gospel, with the truth of God, the cross, sin, these phrases that we use, they get ripped out of the context of the story. And particularly when we're speaking to people who are unchurched, they go, okay, but I don't understand. Why have you started in the middle of the story? They don't even know there is a story. You've just jumped right into sin and the cross. And they're going, huh? What's that about? It's like saying orc to someone who doesn't know Lord of the Rings. Hey, let's go to Mordor. I don't know what that is. I'm not quite sure how that fits into the bigger picture. You see, we've got to look at the story of the gospel before we look at the details. And I do want to look at a couple details this evening that I really think will help us. But before we do that, we need to know the story. And so the story starts in the beginning, because that's how the Bible starts. And this is what we need to know. God is real. God is real. He exists. And He created. Out of the goodness and the creativity of His person, He created. And the pinnacle of His creation was mankind. Man and woman, He created them. And our purpose was to worship Him and walk with Him. That's what we were created for. And we do the two together. By walking with Him, we are worshiping Him, because there is nowhere else we would rather be. He is our purpose, and we are restless without Him. There is a gap. And He creates us, and everything is good. But if you've been in a church long enough, you know that the story doesn't stay that way. In fact, any good story doesn't stay that way, because no good story just stays good the whole way. No twists along the end. There's always a problem that gets inserted so that a hero can come and save the day. Could you imagine a Marvel movie without a bad guy? Kind of bad. And so the fall happens. The problem comes in. Everything falls to pieces. there is disobedience. God gives us one command. So whether it was one or 20, we probably would have broken them. But he gives one. And we break it. And there is disobedience. And wherever there is disobedience, there must be consequence. That's what we need to understand. If we don't get that jump, that logic step, that piece of the story, if we miss that page, the rest of it doesn't make sense. Wherever there is disobedience, if the person who is in charge is just, there will be consequence. God is perfectly just and perfectly holy, and because there is disobedience, there must be consequence. And that consequence comes from the hand of God, and it comes from our own disobedience. You see, our sin, which is our failure to act, think, or feel rightly in light of God. See, sin is not just doing bad things. It's actually not thinking rightly about God. That is sinful. That is because we don't know him well. We are not thinking rightly. We are falling short of the mark we are meant to live up to. We were created for. It is not loving him enough, not serving him enough, not trusting him enough, not obeying him enough, and not cherishing him enough. And in the garden, we didn't cherish him enough or trust him enough. So they ate of the apple, and sin and brokenness enter the world, which is why there is so much pain and suffering, and which is why there is now a rift between us and God. And so wrath as a consequence makes sense in the light of sin. Because sin must not be taken lightly. That is something we need to get another grip. I know Brad mentioned in his sermon, he says, sometimes the reason we struggle with this concept of the wrath of God is because we take sin too lightly. John Bunyan says this, sin is the dare of God's justice. It is the rape of his mercy. It is the jeer of his patience and the slight of his power and the contempt of his love. See, our perspective of sin is very, very vital. If we do not take it seriously, then we cannot understand wrath or hell. It will never make sense to us until we realize the gravity of sin. But also, we can't fully appreciate grace. That's why you have to understand the whole story. Even the grace part isn't as sweet or good if you don't realize how bad and heavy and real sin is against God. In Ephesians, Paul says that we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of our body and mind, and we were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. By nature, we were children of wrath, because we were by nature sinners. By nature opposing God, not seeking him, not cherishing him, not loving him, and not serving him. In Romans, Paul writes that God looked out over the world for one person who was seeking him and found not one. He goes through all the criteria and says even the Jews who had the law, the revelation of God in their hands, fell short of the standards of the glory of God. Sin is as serious as death, because sin is paid for with death. Death is the price. It is the consequence we pay for disobeying God. It is the consequence we pay for not fully cherishing him and loving him in every moment. This is the reality of a people who have disobeyed and who are not walking the purpose they were intended to walk. To walk with him and to worship him. And we start worshiping ourselves or other things. And that's what we call idolatry. You see, here's the thing, the gravity of sin, the gravity of the sin, if we want to talk about a particular sin, must actually not be measured by what it is, but by who it's against. See, your sin won't look bad to you if you don't realize who you've sinned against. God, looking at how holy and perfect and pure he is and what he expects of his creation, and then realizing that you have sinned against him, you have blasphemed against him, you have insulted him. That shows us the gravity of our sin. And there are consequences. You see, sin creates an uncrossable chasm between us and God. We stand there at the edge and look across and we go, how am I meant to get across this? How am I meant to find a way through this ocean, this vast chasm, abyss between me and my Creator, me and the one I was created to be with, me and the one I was created to worship? That is why God takes sin so seriously. Because it creates a chasm between us and Him. Your sin, no matter how small you think it is, has created a gap between you and God, and there is nothing that we can do to cross it. See, the entire Old Testament is a part of the story. It shows us that there is no prophet, no priest, and no person who can cross it themselves. They could never do enough to bridge that gap. That is why we go through this whole process of having judges and prophets, and they come and they fail, and the people repent, but then they always turn back. And God says, but I'm promising you there will come one person who will finish this. He will be priest, prophet, and king. He will be Emmanuel, God with you, and He will complete the task of bridging that gap. But here's the thing, it's not just a gap. It's not just that we're stuck. It's that far off in the distance, there is a tidal wave approaching us of the wrath of God. See, the consequence of being disobedient is that we are separated. But the punishment for that disobedience is God's wrath towards us, and it is fast approaching. And when it hits us, we will be always drowning and never dead. See, when we see the holiness of God and the gravity of our sin, we will realize our deep need to be rescued, to be saved. We will realize that we are just damsels in distress, even the most macho of our men, needing to be restored and rescued and plucked out of the water. But we need to see that to really fully appreciate the rescue, the grace. If you're not convinced you're drowning, you won't appreciate the person who rescues you. See, I was 14 years old when I first entered a church. I wasn't raised a Christian. I'd never really heard the gospel. I walked in there because I liked skating and they had ramps. It was a good mix. And I heard probably not the most friendly youth talk. It was quite hell and brimstone, which you might think is a bad strategy, but it worked for me. And it piqued my interest. And I felt something, just an inkling of something in my heart happening there, something I needed to know about. Mentioned there was judgment, mentioned sin, and mentioned Jesus, and I needed to investigate this further. And so, to the surprise of my parents, I started going to church. And as I started to discover the gospel and started to understand that there was a God who I had offended, I started to feel in me something I hadn't really felt before, a deep-seated lack that something was not right. There was a need that needed to be fixed. There was an insecurity that needed to be solved. I was guilty and desperate to be rescued and restored. And it was at that point, when I surrendered, that Christ rescued me and I began to follow Him. But a bit later on, the guilt manifested itself and I became a bit of a Pharisee. Someone who was overly religious, overly critical, overly harsh. I started to judge my own relationship with God by how well I was doing, because although I had entered into the kingdom, I still hadn't fully understood that I hadn't got there on my own effort. I still hadn't understood fully that it was all God's grace that had got me there and was supposed to keep me there. And so I started to be overly critical on all my friends, judging them and hurting people, as happens, because the basis for my acceptance was my good deeds, my good Christianity, my biblical memorization, my Bible knowledge, having the answers. And you know what solved that? It was encountering the grace of God again, realizing that I am deeply in need of rescuing. And even when I am a Christian, I sometimes always want to default into rescuing myself, swim across the chasm myself, but that is not the way it works. And it all began by feeling that deep need to be forgiven and rescued. I'm convinced of this. Nobody becomes a Christian without first experiencing deep. You cannot have a Savior without feeling you need to be saved. Jesus cannot be the rescuer if you're not needing to be rescued. If you don't even think you've done wrong, how can you be justified by God? There needs to be a deep need for rescuing for you to actually come to the cross and say, Jesus, you're all I have. You're all I need. You need to experience that deep lack, that deep need for Jesus to come and fill it. And here is the good news. God has made a way through Jesus to do just that. That is the gospel. This is the climax of the story. Jesus saves the day. That's why it's all about him. You don't hear a story about the damsel. The movie's not called the person who got saved out of the car when it was about to get blown up. It's called Superman. Or Batman, if you like Batman. Right? You see, when we were drowning and in need of saving, the gospel is this. God has acted. He has made a way. Jesus is the personification of the grace of God toward us. And what you and I could not do, God has done. The need has been completely met. You see, when you feel that deep need, when it sits down and you go, I have offended God, the creator of all things, and I have offended him, I have blasphemed him, I have insulted him with my words and my actions, and I could never love him enough. When you feel that need to be rescued, and then rescue comes, you go, thank you. When rescue comes, you go, yes, and you cling to the person who's pulling you out of the slimy pit. And you cherish that arm that pulls you into freedom and liberty. And Jesus, being God in the flesh, lives a perfect life, dies a sacrifice on a cross, and is raised to life so that we can be restored by having faith in him. See, that's the climax of the story. That Jesus has died in your place, been raised from the dead to confirm everything that he said, to confirm the validity of the story. And now by trusting in him, you can have life. You can be restored. Your guilt can be cleansed and wiped away. The chasm can be closed. And the wrath can be satisfied. And I want to look at two doctrines that we see on the cross. Two things that happen, because the cross is a complex thing. What happens there is supernatural. When Jesus dies for our sins, it's not just a physical sacrifice. It's not just nails and wood. If we ever diminish it to just that, we lose out on the significance and the meaning behind that historical event that we believe in. And so I want to look at two things that happen on the cross. And I hope they bring you encouragement and reason to worship. I'm going to read from Romans 3, verses 22-25. It says this, there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There's the need. Here is it being met. And are justified by his grace as a gift through redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. I want to look at that word propitiation. And I want to explain it. It's not a difficult word. It's a long word. I struggle to say it sometimes. But it's a beautiful word. It's in 1 John as well. And I recently encountered that as I was going through it in my personal time. And I was just again struck by the depth of Jesus being our propitiation. Propitiation is this. It is that Jesus in himself on the cross absorbed the wrath of God that was towards you and me. That's what it means. It means he is the wrath-absorbing sacrifice. So he doesn't just die in your place so that you're forgiven. He actually drinks the cup of wrath on your behalf. Voluntarily. See, on the cross, Jesus fully absorbed every last drop God's wrath towards you, because it couldn't just go nowhere. You hear these illustrations about how we're, and they're great illustrations, but they're actually just missing the little bit about this, you know, maybe this tidal wave or something, it's coming towards you, and it's God's wrath, and it's about to crush you, but then the cross happens, and you believe in Jesus, and so there's this big pit that opens up, and the water just goes, and you're like, yeah. But what they forget to mention is at the bottom of that pit is Jesus drinking every last drop. It doesn't just go nowhere. The wrath isn't just diverted. Jesus takes it himself for the joy set before him. He drinks every last drop. All of the displeasure that God had towards you and your sin. All of the anger that God had towards you and your sin. All of the wrath that God had towards you and everything you have done to offend him was absorbed like a sponge by Jesus on the cross. Propitiation. Remember that word and rejoice. That the wrath that was toward you and your sin, that when you were at one stage a child by very nature of wrath, you have now become a child of God and the wrath has been taken on your behalf. All the condemnation that we deserve was poured out on Jesus. Consider this. Jesus had never known anything other than the love of the Father. He had never ever experienced any measure of discouragement or disunity. Him and the Father always had a perfect relationship. The Father had always only ever given love to the Son. And yet for our sake, the Father has to go through the turmoil of pouring out wrath on his Son. And the Son willingly takes the wrath he had never experienced in his life on himself. All he'd known was love. All that had ever existed between the Father and the Son was love. And for our sake, wrath was absorbed and meted out. Satisfied. That is a glorious truth. The other doctrine or truth I want to speak about is one called imputed righteousness. Imputed righteousness. I'm going to read a couple of scriptures to you. In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21, it says this, "For our sake, he, God, made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, perfect, to be sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." In Romans 5:17 it says, "Much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through one man." Free gift of righteousness. This is what imputed righteousness means. It means God imputes, he credits, he ascribes to Jesus our sin. And then the other way around, Jesus' righteousness gets credited, ascribed, imputed to us. You see, when we believe, what happens is a spiritual thing. We get merged with Jesus. Our faith unites us to him. And then a beautiful exchange happens. That's what Martin Luther called it. It's a beautiful exchange. Jesus, in his body, becomes all of our sin. I can't even comprehend that, but I know it's true. He becomes our sin, and our sin dies on the cross. And God pours his wrath out on it. But on the other side of the coin, Jesus' perfect life, his perfect standing with God, his righteousness gets credited to you and me. So that when God looks at us, all he sees is the righteousness of God, the righteousness of Christ on us, covering us. Perfectly. And that's how he relates to us. When you come towards him, you come through Jesus, having been covered by his righteousness and cleansed by his blood. That's how God receives you. That's how he sees you. And that's how you can come to him in prayer and in worship. Jesus takes all our sin and we receive all of his righteousness. Again, grace. God's goodness to those who are undeserving. What an unfair exchange. What a terrible business deal. And God does it. Takes all of our sin and gives us all of his righteousness. Just consider this, that Jesus felt it. A person who had never experienced guilt, never experienced shame, had never put a foot wrong in all eternity, experienced for the first time on our behalf, for our sake, guilt. We are so used to that, it's like, what? Guilt. For the first time, he experienced it, and he took it on himself. Our sin, your sin, my sin, he took it on himself. That is grace. That is God's goodness towards us who believe. That is the gospel for these parts of it. In Jesus, we have received the goodness of God. As an undeserving people, we have been lavished with the grace of God. And I pray we never become too familiar with these truths. I pray they would always stun us and lead us into deeper worship and deeper devotion. We are never without reason to worship God, who has made a way through his Son for us to know him, to love him, to cherish him, and to walk with him. We're going to worship soon, but I don't want to skip a moment to ask if there's anyone who has not been in a relationship with God, who has not been brought to life. What I mean by that is this: you haven't seen Jesus as he is, as your Savior, as the one who is rescuing you, and said, I put all my trust in you and I cherish you. Faith is trusting, believing, and cherishing. And so can I ask if we can just close our eyes? We're going to pray and then we're going to go into worship as we close. And if there is anyone who wants to submit, to surrender, to say, I feel that need for the first time maybe, that need for rescuing, that need for saving, to be saved, to be rescued, to have my sin taken away and dealt with, and to have the righteousness of God cover me, the guilt dealt with, and the shame dealt with. If you feel that need, you want to just surrender and say, God, I am here, I trust in Jesus. You just want to stick up your hand if that's you, so I can pray for you. Put your hand down. I just want to pray for you, and if that is you, I would just encourage you to come and speak to one of the pastors or leaders or to a friend who you know is walking closely with Jesus. Just let them know that this has happened. I'm just going to pray for us, and then we're going to worship together. Oh God, I thank you for your glorious grace. Thank you, God, that we have a way into relationship with you where we were at one stage purposed and walking with you and we were disobedient. Thank you, God, that you have made a way to deal with the consequences of that. And we can now walk again with you. God, I pray for the person who has raised their hand. And for anyone who feels that need in their heart but maybe didn't feel ready to raise their hand, I pray, God, that you would just bring revelation of how good you are, your goodness towards us who are undeserving, that we don't have to do anything to receive it, that all you require of us is faith and trust. And so won't you raise up faith in all of us, God, and particularly for those who feel that response in them, that we would trust you with our entire being and say, yes, we have fallen short, but we rest in the grace of Jesus and what he has done on the cross, and we rejoice and worship and surrender our lives to you because of that. Because of your grace towards us, God, we commit ourselves to you and to following you and to knowing you and to unpacking all that it means to be in a relationship with you. And we thank you that that's made possible through the blood of Jesus, what he's done on the cross. And I just pray that you would guide all of us, and again, particularly for those who are responding. And God, I pray now that as we have just contemplated your grace, won't you just raise up in us just a heart of gratitude for all that you have done, all that you have done for us in Jesus, who is your grace personified. Won't you raise up in us hearts now of thankfulness and worship and joy, because Jesus is the good news of great joy. Amen. Won't you stand with me? We're going to go into a space of worship now. I've asked Tammy to do a hymn.